From the University of Michigan's Mendelssohn Theater, please join students from their business school, a special edition of CEO Exchange, our continuing series of conversations in business and leadership.
The University of Michigan Business School welcomes CNN Senior Analyst Jeff Greenfield.
Thank you.
欢迎大家来到首席执行官访谈节目，我是杰夫·格林菲尔德。在这富有挑战性的新经济里，所有的新企业都仍然面临着一些非常头疼的问题。假设你拥有一家公司，你按照老一套方式做生意，你制造产品并把它们卖给全世界的客户，如果有人批评你说你的产品污染了空气、水源，甚至危害人类的健康，你该如何回答？这就是道公司化学公司面临的挑战之一。如果贵公司属于那种新兴企业，你希望在互联网上占据一席之地，从新兴的电子商务中分上一杯羹，你要如何应付大批的竞争者？他们也从电子商务中看到了宝贵的商机。作为一家成立两年半的 IT 企业，北北生化电子商务就面临着来自许多竞争者的挑战。该公司受到许多投资者的青睐，不过目前还没有盈利。等一下我们将见到北北生化电子商务的首席执行官，不过首先上场的是陶氏化学公司的首席执行官威廉·史泰尔·帕尔斯先生。在收购了联合碳化物公司后，陶氏化学公司现在是全球第二大的化学公司，它属于那种一提起名字仍然能激起人们对从前的论战的联想的公司。
1987年，一位叫做亨利·陶的年轻化学家提出了一个简单的计划，他打算把密歇根州米德兰地区丰富的矿产转变为可获利的资源。根据这个想法，一家新的公司诞生了。今天我们拥有的是销售额达$20亿的企业，客户几乎遍布全球每一个角落。率领陶氏化学公司进入新世纪的是威廉·史泰洛帕尔斯先生，他的父母是希腊的移民，他在纽约的长岛长大，帮助其父母打理糖果和冰激凌生意。读中学的时候，曾和棒球传奇巨星卡尔·亚斯特雷姆基共同打过球。尽管一次受伤中断了他的体育生涯梦想，现在在陶氏化学公司办公室，他仍然显示了自己对这项运动的热爱。在两人面对面的交流中，他也许不会给你留下首席执行官的印象，因为他的这种个人形象不突出，肯定不像你们所接触过的那些首席执行官。比尔毕业于福德汉姆大学，取得了医学化学学位，之后在华盛顿大学获得了医学化学的博士学位。1967年，他进入了陶氏化学公司之后，一直为该公司效力。1995年，他出任首席执行官。如果要我说，他在作为首席执行官上所做的最大贡献是什么？我觉得应该是为公司制定了更宏伟的目标，使员工能够跳出原有局限，思考他们所取得的成就，并着手证明这一点。上任以来，比尔放弃了大约$1亿的业务，包括陶氏化学公司的日用消费品业务。此外，他还筹划了收购联合碳化物公司的行动。今天，陶氏化学公司最成功的产品是甲基与维素，它可用作电影胶片的黏膜，也可用作许多食品的包装袋。人们甚至会将它误认为草莓派。甲基与维素体现了陶氏化学公司的整体商业方案，即先设计一种产品，然后到市场上说服许多行业来使用这种产品，比如电子烷。这可是今天市场上最好的苹果纤维素。
Boy,
That's about the best methyl cellulose I've had today.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the President and CEO of Dow Chemical, Bill Stavropoulos. 董事长兼首席执行官比尔·史泰泰。
Welcome. Have a seat. Not bad.
Yeah, that's
pretty good. 谢谢。您是1967年进入陶氏化学公司的？
是的。
If you'd have been on Dow Chemical
in 1967, my guess is the reaction might have been a tad different. The whole napalm issue was strong.
Did it give you any pause to think about joining a company that was that controversial? 你了解他们的想法，就会，我知道那时看起来公司的高级管理层确实认为自己销售的正是政府希望他们销售的产品，他们这么做是为了国家的利益，是爱国行为，并且因为战争最终引起了许多争议，我想他们失去了公众的支持，并且这一来支持战争的人成了被攻击的目标，陶氏化学当然也不例外。但是那时我认为公司的立场是，这是政府要求的，这是公司必须做的。
这一点很有意思，如果是二战，人们就不会。
没错。
您刚进入陶氏化学公司的环境，所有这些争议可能在某种意义上在您脑海里树立了这样一种观点，即这家公司，应该说所有的公司都不应受到这些争议的束缚。我们既然造出了产品，我们就得把它卖掉。
我相信是这样。我觉得这个年代，不止现在，以前也一直如此，只不过没有明确表达出来。但是还有一个可持续性的问题，有三个方面要兼顾：经济、环境和社会。靠牺牲任何一方的代价来满足另一方，都是行不通的。
At the expense of any other one.
This is, as we mentioned at the outset, a company that's a little more than 100 years old. And in some sense, it's a traditional company. I mean, in this world, you actually make things.
Right.
Take things out of the ground, you process them, you sell. It's really good, right? It's a kind of a new concept probably to some people who only know about that.
But we're still out there.
But that also implies certain, I would think, limits. That is, it's a cyclical business, it's mature in some ways. And when you came in as CEO, it seems to me that you took a risk. You were trying to say to this very traditional company, we've got to change it for roots. Talk about that.
Yeah, I think that a company has been very successful.
好的，我认为作为一家成功的企业，当然，如果我们不成功，企业也不可能生存那么久。我们该改变了，是时候明白世界已经改变了。如果我们不相应地做出改变的话，我们将会被淘汰。所以我们开始是为公司树立新的目标，制定新的战略。我们改变的是产品组合、组织结构和企业文化。公司中没有哪个方面是我们没有改变的。
Isn't this a little like turning around the QE2?
The most difficult thing to do is to change a successful company. If you have a burning platform, if your back's to the wall, you can rally people very quickly. So you have to spend a lot of time articulating why you want to change, how you want to change, and you have a promising future. You have to paint that future. You have to paint a story where people can find themselves in that story contributing. And that's what we try to do every single day in our company.
Another part of your strategy was to use the buzzword downsizing. I mean, you not only eliminated a whole bunch of middle management levels, but I think it was 10,000 people,
right?
Now, Dow is in Midland, Michigan, right? That's a pretty small community compared to Chicago,
right?
So it must have been that you were saying to people who you not only had worked with, but lived with, maybe gone to school, their kids and your kids went to school, you're not here anymore.
That's right.
Now, you know, people like yourself are thought of as pretty tough-minded guys. Was that emotional?
Very emotional, because it was a time when you had to, and everybody in the company had to, look at their operation and say, what did they have to do to make this world competitive? Because if we didn't, We know we wouldn't be around as a company. Some of the divestitures became very emotional because you became attached to the products, attached to the people, attached to your customers, and what it does for the customers. But on the other hand, when the facts are laid out there and people see a better future somewhere else, there's a readily acceptance.
Well, that's what I want to talk about a little bit. For one thing, the stuff when I was a kid I knew about Dow,
it
still didn't have the name, but it's not yours anymore,
right?
Oven cleaners, all that stuff is not yours.
Saran wrap, exactly.
But part of what it seems to be you're trying to do with Dow is to create a whole new line of products that really are environmentally friendly. I mean, I don't know if you're wearing one now, but you actually do a shirt that's made out of corn. This must come in handy when you run out of food. But I mean, that's a radically different notion.
One of the things that's happened, if you look at chemistry and science, or science, chemistry-based company, is that what we're trying to do is leverage that knowledge to solve mankind's problems.
我敢说，如果没有化学工业、没有化学科技，我们目前的生活质量和标准是无法想象的。作为一家企业，我们的责任是表明这一点，并重新定位，以便更好地服务于我们前面提到的可持续性发展。
To the sustainability that I talked about earlier.
Would it be fair to say this represents, for the company and for the chemical industry in general, a fairly dramatic change in corporate culture? Because I think there was a time when it was a lot more defensive a generation or two ago.
Yeah, and I think you get defensive when you get attacked, you naturally get defensive. And I think that over the last several years, number of years, we've tried to be at the forefront of things and try to take a leadership role, not only in our industry, but in the industry in general. Because active engagement with your public is extremely important.
And
we do it in many ways. At every one of our plant sites, what we have is a citizens group that is an advisory group to our facilities. And that's a way to understand what the publics need and what we need so that we can work together.
It's such a cliche when the head of a major company talks about roots, but it's so often true. Tell us about the family you came from.
Well, I came from an immigrant family. My father was a candy maker and an ice cream maker. He came to his country when he was 14 years old.
他没念过书,
had no education,
后来他找到了一份工作,
by the way. And he went to work. And he found a job in the started a little candy kitchen out in the eastern end of Long Island. And he kind of built that up.
But something happened to the candy company that it seems had a pretty big impact, not only on your family, but on your whole life.
When I was a very young man, my father lost everything, and he was about 58 years old.
那个时候他五十八岁，突然之间只能站柜台了。他干了三四年的售货员，情况逐渐好转。但是我们生活中的一个转折点，首先这是我们一家人更团结，另外也给了我们许多经验，告诉我通过不懈努力和自信，可以重新振作起来。但我看来，我父亲是我见到过第一位成功的、克服挫折的人。实际上，他也是第一位商业上的老师。
但许多在八九岁时一样，也有自己的梦想。但是你的梦想超过了普通人，因为你和我不一样，你有自己的梦想。是的，我和卡尔·亚兹特雷姆基一起长大，梦想成为职业棒球运动员。
卡尔后来被波士顿红袜队效力，并进入了名人堂。卡尔是我的邻居。
我们在同一所学校上学，一起毕业的有二十八个人。他和我都有这个梦想。不过，当击打曲线球变得困难时，我意识到我最好是干点别的。您的水平比大多数人高多了，卡尔想。那么一点儿，就那么一点儿的足够了。为可口可乐公司已故前任总裁的一句话说：“为可口可乐工作是使命的召唤。”
What he said was that working for Coca-Cola is a calling. It's not a way to make a living. It's a religion. Is that how you look at what you do? I think what you have to do. I look upon you have to do what you like. And so that you can put your sweat and guts into it, and it's not work.
It's
something that you really, really enjoy.
你知道，人们向我提的问题启发了，提醒了我，
give me some advice on what I should do.
选一样你喜欢的工作，其余的人一切都会随之而来。这是我的理解。还有，公司周围要有对公司充满同样的敬畏。
Bill will be talking to you again in a few minutes. Thanks very much for joining us. See you in a bit. As I mentioned,
我们的下一位嘉宾 David Paley 已经有过两次成功创业的历史 最近一次是北美生化电子商务公司的成功 它有点像约会服务 利用网络把寻找化工和实验室产品的买方和卖方联系起来 尽管北美生化电子商务的利润还不够理想 它的商业模式在华尔街肯定会引起轰动 31岁时David就成了
At 31 years old, David Perry is CEO of what may be the biggest company you've never heard of, Chemdex.
You'll never see a box, you'll never see a warehouse.
That's because Chemdex is a business-to-business e-commerce company, linking companies selling life science and lab products to buyers through the internet. Users can choose among 1 million products and order them online. In 3 years, 80% of the $1.3 trillion internet market is expected to be business to business. Perry is positioned to get a chunk.
It's an environment like I've never seen before in the sense that the opportunities are absolutely endless.
Though it is a virtual company, Chemdex is spinning real numbers on Wall Street. Chemdex went public in July 1999 at $15 a share.
4 months later, market capitalization of $1 billion.
They've nailed the infrastructure issue.
But the one thing David Perry hasn't handled yet is profits.
I'm not concerned that we do not turn a profit, but I'm very focused on eventually turning a profit. I view our stage of business today is investing for the future.
Chemdex was started while Perry was at Harvard Business School. It was the second startup for the chemistry major from Arkansas. The first was Virogen, a biotech company.
Chemdex, in fact, was the fourth business plan I wrote while I was in business school.
我放弃了其他三个计划在哈佛佩里花在商务上的时间比花在课本上的多我认为他的学校里学那些学生但不是最优秀的学生他是一班都对他从小门后的座位印象深刻每个人都对电子商务感兴趣戴维是家里的长子也是家里第一位大学毕业生他在艾利克森工作第六岁的时候我就开始为父母
公司干活。每小时25美分，以后每年增加25美分。其实12岁的时候，我 们小时都可以挣2美元了。尽管戴维对他阿肯色的出身感到骄傲，他和Chemdex都着眼于未来。Though David Perry is proud of his Arkansas roots, he and Chemdex are all about the future.
女士们、先生们，这是一位30出头的首席执行官，他的思想价值20亿美元。Chemdex David Paley。
欢迎，和比尔一样，也没有。我认为，你并没有出生于富贵之家。一个普通的家庭。
If I read your biography, you accepted MIT, couldn't go.
Well, my parents told me when I was 14 years old, and remember it very clearly, actually. They said, there's two things we're not going to give you. It's a car and a college education. I was really bummed about the car.
But it was a fair statement. It didn't indicate that they didn't think college was important, because education was something that they pushed from even before we were in school.
But it was something that they felt like we needed to earn on our own. And
by telling me early, that was fair. It gave me the opportunity to prepare myself, put myself in college.
So I went on and did the best I could. By the time I graduated from high school, I had the opportunity to go a couple of places.
But MIT was one of those places that I couldn't afford. I ended up going to the Air Force Academy for the first 2 years.
Did you have ambitions to Tom Cruise-like Top Gun status?
In fact, Top Gun came out in 1986, which was the year I graduated from high school. I'm sure there's no correlation, however, between that and my choice.
What happened?
我在空军学院那两年，学会了很多。在那里并不是因为喜欢，但是那段宝贵的经历。有一次橄榄球的比赛，受了伤，失去了飞行员的资格。对于一个20岁的年轻人，那是一件可怕的事情。我本可以留下来做一些飞行之外的其他工作，但我认为这不是我理想的工作，所以我决定退役。
Some of us have earned money during the summer doing things like filing, waiting on tables. You had a somewhat different vocational route. What'd you do?
I worked in a salmon cannery in Alaska for 3 summers. I left the Air Force Academy, going to a private school, knew I needed to come up with some money somehow.
知道自己需要一点钱。
后
来我看到一个广告招聘大学生去阿拉斯加，我认为这份工作关键是会有危险性，但是他们说可以挣很多钱，于是我动心了，接着给阿拉斯加的商会打了个电话，得到了这份工作，再次到了一个荒无人烟的地方，最终在那里干了3年，我干得很不错。
那么你有没有赚了很多钱？
很多。
I didn't get hurt.
危险吗？
我没有受过伤。
That's what lawyers call an argumentative denial. 这好像有点类似于律师的诡辩性否认。
That's like when you say, "Do you love me?"
就好像你问你爱我吗？对方回答我一直喜欢你，经常没回答这个问题。
It was pretty rough work.
环境确实危险，这是肯定的。
Let's talk about Chembex.
I think if I wanted to get you angry, which given your
forecast, I don't.
But the thing that apparently you most are at pains to say what you are not is when people start bringing out the Amazon.com analogy. Oh, I get it. You're a website. I can go there and buy stuff off your website.
Good insight.
I'll sit over here.
我等你回答这个问题。
In fact, we are an internet company. And when we
刚成立的时候，我们非常希望人们将我们与其他公司相比。有一段时间，我们甚至将自己称作破产者中的亚马逊，这一直让我很惭愧。我们是一个联系企业与企业的电子商务公司，企业对企业与企业对消费者是完全不同。我们解决供应链上的问题，这是无法靠网站来完成的，必须把消费者和供应商结合起来。我们和亚马逊、电子湾这样的公司之间唯一的共同点，就是我们运作的基础设施都一样。但我们的商业模式差别很大。
但是我觉得非常了不起的一点就是，我想5、6年前人们都不可能想象这样一家公司。我的意思是，如果没有运行良好的互联网，
这就好像电还没有被发现
就要去发明电视机。
我认为应该说所有最成功的网络企业都具备这种特征。我们解决的问题在网络出来之前基本上都无法解决，这意味着你的竞争环境相对明确，对吗？
你和许多其他这一行的公司一样，有两个共同点：一个是你的股票价格突破了极限，另一个是你们还没有盈利。
Explain to us how that works.
请给我们一些解释。
Okay.
好的。
We're starting from no.
我们是白手起家，你知道，当我开始为 Chembex 集资的时候，只有我和我的一个计划，这就是我们所有的资产。因此，你必须投入很多资金来做这件事情，要花几千万美金来提出解决方案。这和建筑真实世界中的大厦没有什么区别。令人们困惑的是，财务是不同的。如果你要造一座化工厂，所有的钱被归于资本，而我们的投资则是费用开支，这些钱用于收集消费者和供应商的情报、市场推广、人员招聘，这是开支。但是主要原则是一样的，我们投入资产，这些资产用于实现一个巨大的机会。
最终你是希望占带子会盈利，对吗？
当然，我们是真正的企业，解决真正的企业问题。杜邦和陶氏化学公司这样的公司和我们做生意，因为我们替他们省钱，或使他们更有效地卖出他们的产品。你这么做的话，你最终会挣钱的。
我这让我想起了另一个问题：为什么有公司想合作，或至少允许你们将他们的产品放在网上？你们的网上也有他们的竞争者的信息，他们这么做有什么好处？
这
正如你说过的，我们一方面关注顾客，另一方面关注供应商。但现在很多时候，人们都要对不同的供应商进行比较，这导致了更高效的市场产生。但是本质上要改变的不是这对公司是否有好处，要判断的是这是否行得通。是的，这会改变你的立场。他们的分析是尽快进入市场，分析如何利用它打败竞争对手。
Their analysis better be to jump in as fast as possible, figure out how to take advantage of it versus their competitors.
You know, that raises a fascinating question, which is in one sense,
because of your company and others like it,
you really have, not you personally, but this has the power to force companies to change everything from pricing to their customer relationships. Once it's all this transparent, once a customer can know immediately, I can get it cheaper, I can get it faster, I can, it can be more what I want. Companies may have no choice but to change not how they do business, but how they make their product and sell it. I mean, am I over the top here?
The things that companies like Chemdex are doing will fundamentally change the way the economy is run. 这样的公司所做的将根本改变经济运作的方式，
这是真的。Are there some businesses that were this kind of company, were a Chemdex, were a dating service, if you will, would not work?
You know, we've been compared to many things. A dating service is a first.
I told you I was a liberal arts major.
我的父母会很骄傲的。是的，我们建立 Chemdex 的时候，明显是想解决一个特定行业的问题。随着我们逐渐成熟，我们意识到我们组合在一起的这个模式和资产能够解决某些问题，但是也并不是万能的。
在您看来 ，Chemdex 这个公司在市场上取得成就是否是可能的？换句话说，比如20年前，如果有人说微软会成为垄断企业，至少看上去像垄断企业，人们可能会感到好笑，得了吧。那些家伙只不过是在车库里小打小闹。
可
今天，没人会这么笑。所以，这种公司如果不是贵公司，他们是否有朝一日会取得这种地位？
我认为没有什么是不可能的。我第一次筹款离目前并不久，我至少被拒绝了40次。他们认为我们根本不可能挣钱，所以我可以想象企业某一天会再次实现这种飞跃。
几分钟后我们将请比尔回来，但我想了解一下您的日常生活。在这么忙的情况下，您的一天是怎样的？假如您确实要到公司去，而不是坐在家里的电脑面前，您几点上班？
我每天醒来，我都在想，这就是我的工作。上床的时候，我也在考虑这个问题。我的工作并不都发生在办公室里，但我一般早上6点起来，大约工作到晚上10点或12点，这只有10日我要做。
这么说，你目前是没有到巴厘岛上小溪旁度假10天的想法了？
我宁愿在家里待10天，真的，只是因为工作有很多乐趣，没有什么其他的事比工作更吸引我了。一个人31岁，必须创建一家公司，并使它从零开始发展到300名员工，让它上市，然后走到这儿。接受您的采访，还有什么别的能够让我做到这一切呢？
我想，该请上一位潜在的合作者还是竞争者，或者该怎么说你们的关系？第二，请回来。您是1967年进入陶氏化学公司的，现在是2000年。您仍然在陶氏化学公司。
You went to Dow Chemical 1967. Right. It's now the year 2000. Right. You're still at Dow Chemical.
Right.
You've been in three companies already, and you're.
您已经在三家公司干过，但是你好像刚才获得了选举权的年龄。
What are you guys laughing?
你们在笑什么？
不过。你能否描绘一下，如果出生在30-40年前，你如何在公司内部晋升？大卫·佩里能够做到这一点吗
？Would this have been something that David Perry could have pulled off?
当我寻找到第一笔资金去创立 Chemdex 的时候，曾经被拒绝过很多次，但我最终拿到了第一份合同，这表示投资商对此有兴趣。后来投资公司的合作人说需要一个
反面的推荐人，一个不会替我说好话的人。接着，这种人有很多了。我介绍了我在 Axon 的上司的上司，他同意推荐我。他对投资商说的和我预想的一样，例如 David 是个聪明的家伙，工作的很努力，但是就是不像个干公司的人。他从不服从管理，以及诸如此类，表明我在那种环境里不会成功的话。
Never allowed me to be very successful in that environment.
Now let's look. 现在我们换话题，看看这位拥有自己公司的年轻人，自己制定规则。
Setting the rules.
如果您今天创立一家公司，您能想象一辈子待在同一家公司吗？
我认为可以。我认为。规模大了带给你的第一件事就是机会多了。我在职业生涯中干过十六七份工作，我觉得理想的工资应该能够发展才能并正确利用才能，让员工有机会成功并提早让他们承担责任。你知道我们公司想得到的目标之一就是类似于 David 这样的人。
对，这就是我想问的。考虑到现实情况，您是否一定要改变您对一个公司人的定义？
Your definition of what a company guy is?
我认为一个特征就是他们希望尽快的承担责任。我和新员工之间只有四到五级管理层，所以这个控制范围很广。这意味着你的员工有很广阔的空间可以发挥，你给他们资源、知识，然后放手去干。
但你是否还应给他们别的东西？你是否应当允许他们有古怪的个性、与众不同的穿着等等？换句话说，是否应当允许个性发展，即使在陶氏化学公司？
In other words, do you have to let weirdness flourish, even at Dow?
我认为是这样的，我们称之为多样化。对多样化的定义是可行的，也是广义的，因为我们的业务遍布126个国家。
您是一个年轻的创业者，很明显。公司在华尔街很成功，但是看看有100年历史的陶氏化学公司，它的市场份额甚至比你们的大，规模大，是否有好处呢？潜意识里，你是否想说，我想知道经营这样一家公司究竟是怎样的呢？
是的，实际上有两个问题：一是陶氏化学公司有什么值得我羡慕的吗？另一个是。比尔有什么值得我羡慕的吗 ？Chemdex 每天都必须证明我们的存在的意义，对吗？每天，人们每时每刻都在判断我们是否履行了我们的承诺，这是我们经营的基础。如果我们让他们失望，那么我们资产的价值就我们的。股票价格会急剧的下降。陶氏化学公司有许多的经营资产，这些资产可以不受影响继续运作，只有一定的稳定性。我会交换位置吗？绝对不会。另一方面，我觉得 Bill 的工作很有趣。我觉得今日经济领域的英雄不是那些和我做同样事情的人，而是和 Bill 做同样事情的人。他们有活力、耐心和动力来接管一家企业，这比我每天所做的难多了。
That's a much harder thing than what I do on a day-to-day basis.
自从您出任首席执行官以来，您认为新世纪里您的成功会面临什么挑战？这些挑战几年前，您甚至根本没有考虑。
Might not even have to think about or a few years ago.
A CEO's job is
首席执行官的职责就是你知道。策略、计划，能够表达出这种想法，并提出相应的策略来支持，这是必须要做的。另外，还要培养并鼓励一支愿意这么做的团队。你必须鼓励他们，因为路途上有许多障碍要克服。但是，我认为新世纪的特别之处在于技术。技术革命肯定会发生。21世纪会让过去的世纪看起来像慢性子。
谈谈您的决策速度。我的意思是，回公司2年半前根本不存在。公司赖以运行的工具几年前也不存在。衔接的过程中，您是否预料到自己必须遵守老式的决定模式？譬如备忘录、部门划分、上行下达、分析情况、市场调查，这些可是非常过时的了。
That's deader than Marley's ghost.
我认为两个世界的根本区别在于速度。我们成功是因为我们一直在学习，两年的时间里我们学了很多。我们现在已经掌握了未来3到4年必须了解的一个小部分知识。让我们成功的是我们愿意在信息有限的情况下做决策，并判断其是否正确。如果不正确，我们可以改正；如果正确，我们则巩固成果。
您是否在陶氏化学公司里也保证这种决策速度？无论有多困难。
我想可以。我的意思是，我并不打算像 David 的公司快，但我认为优点在于将决策权尽可能下放，保证决策是由内行做出的。而且我认为规模帮我们很多，因为5000万或者1亿美元的决策错误并不能动摇陶氏化学公司这样的公司。如果你继续学习、吸收知识，并把它们应用于公司，我认为区别出色和平庸公司的企业的因素在于重新应用知识的能力，经常吸收知识，并把它们应用于产品、服务和提高员工的能力。
And apply it to your products and services and your people. 我想提出一个在座某位教授可能想问的问题。在我提问之前，我想给二位给未来 MBA 的一点建议。在座有一些人希望成为新世纪的首席执行官，给他们一点建议。
If there are folks out there who aspire to be a 21st century CEO, give them one piece of advice.One practical piece of advice that will help them.
I'd say focus on learning.
关注学习。
Your
目前你们的风险系数很低。正如如果你进入一家公司干得不错的话，谁会在乎呢？你必须获得很多知识。你唯一可能犯的错误是进入无法成长的环境。只要你在快速的学习，你就选对了地方。我觉得自学是你们应该优先考虑的另一点。我要说的就是应该做自己喜欢的工作，因为那样一来学习很容易，你和你身边的人都会从中获得乐趣。所以应努力寻找这样的工作，不要害怕冒职业上的风险。David 也说过这一点，冒险吧，尤其是现在，我认为你们会做得更好，因为你们从中获益了。
我们邀请了几位密歇根州立大学的教授提问。第一个问题来自于企业策略和国际商务副教授阿兰·阿夫哈。除了您自己的商务模式以外，您最喜欢哪种商业模式？您最喜欢哪些方面？
我认为最理想的模式是我们从中可以在某种商品上采取基本定位，借此扩张到新的市场和价值链，并从中获益。电子湾的模式是我见过的最有吸引力的模式。两个人成立了一家公司，在卧室里出售了 PEZ 拍摄火机，并成长为一家价值为20亿美元的公司。在我看来，20亿是因为它还在发展。你的客户越多，在经销商眼里你就越有价值。想和你竞争的新公司总是处于劣势，因为他们的客户和供应商比较少。
我必须问一个问题，希望你能如实回答。当您听到人家像 David 描述电子湾那样描述此类的公司，说他们一开始是在卧室里卖手机的，现在您回顾过去，会说我有过一家公司，我们生产、运输、销售到全公司、全世界，我们已经花了几百万美元进行研究，而这些家伙只是卖手机就坏掉到20亿美元时，你有没有一觉醒来就说我什么地方不对劲了？
Well, how can I get a little bit of that? All right.
我有时也想怎么才能赚上一点钱。不过 Jeff， 这个问题提得很好。我认为像我们这样的公司应该向他们学习。我认为也许5年后我们这样的公司和 David 那样的公司会进行一些合作。
那么说你并不妒忌电子湾获得的市场利润？
我羡慕他们。
我想换个话题。正如两位刚才所说，今天的商务模式和摩根公司那个时代不同，甚至和20年前也不同了。有环境的问题，有知识产权的问题， 无论你多么关注平衡，你可以说我们制造产品在市场上它是有用的，可以为我们赚钱。这种产品可能有负面影响，但我们必须继续生产，因为这是我们的业务。
我们的责任是确保最有效的提高效率，以符合环保的方式进行制造。
这包括您的家乡吗？你刚才说了，你的兰德是个小镇，你有没有致力于保护水源大气，确保你们在梅德兰经营活动不会有问题？
当然，
因为我听说过去 Midland 经常有破坏环境的警报。
对，当排污过多的时候，事实情况是公司很早以前就意识到这样不行，我们必须停止污染环境，因为减少污染保护环境确实有好处，因此我们将环保作为我们的战略之一。
下面是前商学院的约瑟夫·怀特的提问。
化学公司对环境的影响是个很敏感的话题。您认为公司对环保的责任是什么？您觉得什么是可持续性发展的企业？
1980年以前，公司的管理员并没有提到可持续性这个词，但他们的管理原则确实反映了可持续性的企业文化。
在某种意义上，你一定觉得自己很幸运，因为很多问题在你领导的公司并没有出现，对吗？但是，您是否考虑过可能会出现这些问题？就应该销售什么产品的问题？如
果
我会被允许销售这些产品的问题？
或者是这不是你认为一部分的你的关心吗？
在 Chemdex 有很多问题我们无需担心，但是基本上如果公司内部员工认为所做的是正确的，那么这就是一家了不起的公司。
Chemdex 一个优点就是我们的客户都是医药或者是生物技术的企业，他们的研究使世界更加美好。
这些公司所做的是很多是研究工作和基因工程，这是目前最有争议的一个问题之一。无论作为一名商人还是普通公民，这有没有使您担心化学和生命科学世界的未来发展方向？
是的，
我在考虑这个问题。作为一位科学家，我对此是抱有偏见的。当生物技术20年前出现的时候，人们很担心将会产生什么样的产品，对社会有什么影响。事实上，生物技术是科技带给我们最了不起的行业之一。依靠它，我们可以减轻许多痛苦。转基因食品还有些问题，但人们正在运用同样的技术解决这些问题。我想，我们可以教育人们，让他们明白，这不是一件可怕的事情。
I think as we educate people and people begin to understand that this isn't something to be feared, that the upside is enormous.
Is this kind of concern about biofoods? Is this something where
your adversaries in this area are off the rails?
No, I don't think so. I think David talked about the
我认为 David 已经谈出了巨大的利益问题。我认为我们从事的是工业生物技术，包括植物科学、生物技术还处于起步阶段。如果把整个生物科技比作这座礼堂，我们目前还只有一只杯子的高度。我们要做的就是让公众理解什么是生物科技，这需要实验。一旦人们了解它的效益、负面影响，人们就能正确对待它。我认为它将完全被社会接受，因为它可以提供更多的粮食、新的可回收产品，对环境影响也很小。我的意思是，它的潜力很大。
New renewable products, a less environmental footprint. I mean, it has tremendous potential.
Okay, we have one more question from关于领导的提问的人，你很熟悉，就是他提出了核心竞争力的概念。他就是工程管理和企业战略教授普拉特哈特先生。
David,
你们构成了非常有趣的对比，因为搞的是传统的大企业，另一位靠 IT 业请假。这两种模式都在发展变化。当我们展望未来10年时，你们认为基本的领导问题是什么？
从领导来
I like David's answer to that question earlier.
我本来是希望先听一听 David 的看法的，不过我认为未来十年的基本问题是工业场所的环保问题、技术转让。人们该如何在全球范围内进行技术转让，以便提高生活标准？此外，将来信息传递是即时的，资本和技术都是流动的。唯一能够区分企业好坏的标准，就是其理念的不同和实施这些观点的能力。在此条件下，第三个基本问题就是能否迅速做出决定。
因为
这正是目前我这个位置的偏见，但是我认为技术是推动大部分事物前进的因素。我认为最大的挑战是了解技术及其发展方向，但最重要的是了解它对于商业各个方面的影响。
The students at the University of Michigan Business School, these, you know, might be interested in even, you know, a lot tougher one, we'll find out. But first, we wanted to give you a little background on the University of Michigan. Michigan is one of only five business schools to be on Business Week's top 10 lists continuously since 1988. The business school here is a small, select community that's tucked into a corner of the Ann Arbor campus. Last year, the business school, the University of Michigan, celebrated its 75th anniversary.
去年密歇根州立大学商学院庆祝成立75周年，现在由我们的 MBM 提问。
Hi,
我是杰夫·莫格维兹，我想问史泰尔·派尔斯先生，我想重新提到那个环境问题。首先，如果陶氏化学公司在60年代就意识到这个问题，那么它是否还会生产凝固汽油？第二，陶氏化学公司有没有哪种产品是你们认为可以盈利，但是符合其他标准的呢？
几年前，
我们在实验室里开发了一种不错的新型塑料。这种产品在汽车工业用途很广，这是一种耐高热的产品，可以抵御炉子的高温。我们以为普通塑料的时代就要结束了，但是进一步研究和发现，在生产过程中会产生一种有毒物质，而我们又无法克服这一点，所以这个计划就放弃了。对于那些这个项目的人来说，这很令人失望，因为他们本来已经取得了突破性的进展，但从长远的角度来看，这么做是正确的。至于环境保护问题，我认为如果我们意识到问题，我们会向更多的人咨询，也是我们的决定，让所有的人满意。
On the subject of technology and environmental technology, Dow has been a leader in the field of environmental management and Chemex is a leader in the internet economy. How do you or both of you see the role of the web as a way to both improve environmental management and also improve information flow to the stakeholders about the chemical industry?
Go ahead, you start and I'll...
Since you took the other one first, all right. The beauty of the internet is that fundamentally it improves communication. It's just one of the problems that the environmental movement has had is that you've got this disparate set of people who have a hard time marshaling their resources together. If you think about how the internet can solve that problem, it's pretty powerful. You can suddenly take all those resources and put them in one place, apply them to the same problem. Now, as to specifics, I think what we're going to see is, as that happens, companies that are the target of environmental activism are going to suddenly see that there is more than a grassroots effort in their hometown. It's a grassroots effort that's global.
In this field, doesn't it put a lot more power in the hands of your potential critics and thus make you even respond more quickly and more thoroughly?
绝对如此，影响很大。在网上，你可以发动全球范围的运动，事实上也确实如此。在环境问题上，我认为网络的威力之一在于你既可以了解你那个社区的情况，也可以了解全世界的形势，因为信息就在网上。我同意，你知道这不是单方面的，大部分的环境问题实际上都是沟通引起的。网络可以很快地为我们解决这些问题。
您
的名字和问题。
Hello, I'm Roger Shugart, and my questions are two questions on the competition for Mr. Perry.
First, what is it that you feel Chemdex has done in the past 2 years to, in fact, beat the competition? The second part is, what is it that you feel Chemdex needs to do in the future that will keep people such as my colleagues here at the university from being your main competition in 2 years from now?
A question and a threat. Very well packaged. So we live in a phenomenal world where the opportunity is enormous, where competition is not entrenched, where capital is accessible, and the technology is clearly understood. It's all about execution.
Right?
It means that anybody can do it. It's all about execution, and execution comes down to people. What Chemdex has done well, and the reason I get to keep my job, is that we put together really fantastic group of people that go for it and do what we do. Whether it's our investors, our board members, our executive team, all the way down to every single person that works here.
Yes, ma'am. My name is Laura Cook, and this question is directed towards Mr. Stavropoulos. You mentioned that one of the things Dow Chemical was doing to accelerate change was to push decision-making down in the organization. What other specific steps is Dow doing to innovate in this new economy?
Well, I believe very strongly that information should flow as soon as it is learned in our company, so that everybody can make those decisions. So that's one thing we're doing. The other is that we have placed our businesses around the world, and in the area of recruiting, it used to be that we hired everybody off the campus,
right out of
undergraduate
college
or at a PhD level. And now we're looking at more MBAs, we're looking at more mid-career hires, so that we can accelerate the change in our company.
My name is Robert Rich. I have a question for Mr. Stavropoulos. If it's possible that Chemdex could become a company that could actually create market power and put the schools to suppliers like yourself, why not take a $50 to $100 million risk of hiring a bunch of internet guys and doing it yourself and knocking him out before he gets too big?
He's got a resume for it.
Yes, Bill.
Yes.
Sure. Yeah.
I think it's a heck of an idea. In fact, we are embracing
Met, and we have a group of people who know Dow very well.
They bring them up Silicon Valley. They spend 4 or 5 days out there brainstorming ideas on how to leverage our technology in new and different ways, and come back to Dow and then develop those ideas.
Dave, would you like to comment on that suggestion?
Yeah. Fundamentally, we now have internet companies and other companies. But 5 years from now, the idea of an internet company will be silly, right? The existing players in these markets have two things that make it difficult to go in and create and do what we do. One is structural, and one is
more capabilities.
The capabilities piece is pretty clear. So if you're an existing distributor, you might be very threatened by Chemdex, but you probably don't have the resources in place, the set of expertise and the skills to do this. So there's a capabilities problem. But even if you can get the money and the capabilities, you've got a structural problem.
And that's that existing players have a really hard time creating a neutral marketplace.
It almost always takes somebody from the outside to do that.
My name is Sachin Gadbi, and the question is directed towards both of you. As CEO of your company, what keeps you up at night?
Execution. It's all about execution. Everything I worry about is those 100 decisions a day that you have to do right.
I think
the thing that keeps me awake is that are we moving fast enough? 你知道战略决定大方向，但实施是有差别的。这就是你在最终分析中担心的，因为你的员工是你最终唯一的竞争对手。Because the only last competitive advantage you have is your workers, your people.
If you think of the question that a lot of chief executives, public and private, do, which is a legacy,
my legacy? Oh,
什么遗产？
I think what I hope to my company when I retire is that he looked back and said he articulated the vision, he put new aspirations in place, and then he developed the strategy and communicated it well, and set the company on a path that will take it into the 21st century and be very successful.
David, I realize you're, you know, at 31, it may be a tad early to start thinking this way, but do you already look at Chemdex and say, you know, I think there's something here that
is going to last? I
don't think about it in those terms, but what I think about doing is creating a long-lasting, important company by solving real problems in the marketplace and getting rewarded for doing that. If in the process we create a model that fundamentally changes the way business is done, that's nice, but it's not what we set out to do.
Okay, we've come to the end of the program. I'd like to thank our guests, Bill Stavropoulos of Dow Chemical, David Perry of Chemdex, for sharing their time and their ideas and their candor. Thank you very much. I want to thank our audience as well for your questions, for your enthusiasm. The whole goal in bringing remarkable CEOs like Bill and David together in each of these programs in our series is to add to the world's marketplace of ideas. 如果说美国的事物就是商业，那么首席执行官访谈节目的目的也即在于此。我是杰夫·格林菲尔德，谢谢，再见。
CEO Exchange, visit PBS Online at the internet address on your screen. To order a video cassette of this edition of CEO Exchange, call PBS Video at 1-800-PLAY-PBS and request program number 102.
You're always selling, right? You're either making money or you're selling to employees and customers. How did you
convince them? It was a great show. You got a lot of good questions.
Yeah, it really was.
Well, I hope so. Well, you're going.
Nobody understood that. I would agree that that is the single biggest issue facing any of these companies.
Right.
Nobody understood that.
Yeah. Did you play minor league?
I played semi-pro with him.
Okay.
Yeah. High school.
So internet taxation has almost nothing to do with the business-to-business side, because those are already happening.
I now actually understand, just from the basis of these two shows, so much more about this world than I did.
And there is, you know, I've been in companies where you couldn't do that, and the difference in service is unbelievable.
And it's good to expose yourself to, you know, new things, what's happening, and that was the time.
You cannot do business anymore with this.
Absolutely.